Thank you, everyone. Hello?
Hello?
Hello? Can you hear that? Is it turned on back there? Microphone? Not yet. It's coming. It's coming. And we're here. Thank you, everybody, for coming in this evening. It's a great pleasure and a real honor to be able to welcome back to the AA for the first time since, I think we've decided since 2006, Mr. Toyo Ito, who's here to lecture on not just his first work, but his latest works that he and the office are working on back in Tokyo. Before I begin, if you could take out your version of this and please just switch it off for the next hour, we would appreciate it. Thank you very much. It has been almost exactly 4 years since Toyo joined us here for a wonderful conversation we had upstairs in the front members' room, where we had about this size audience in an even smaller room for 2 hours, and the building took the load, during which we had a fantastic interview and discussion about the various topics and interests that were percolating through the office then. Since that time, of course, the office has gone on to realize major works in Asia, in Europe, and other places around the world. Interestingly, since Toyo was last with us, we have exhibited, I can think of two separate projects of his in the guise of other exhibitions within the AA. To give you an idea of the breadth of his talent that works in alongside him in the office, we had 3 years ago in the Mitsuru Sasaki exhibition, his Kaka Migahara project at the early planning stage when the structural engineering was being worked out ahead of its eventual realization, the crematorium that many of you will know. Last year, Iwan Ban's architectural photography included a fantastic documentation of his Mikimoto high-rise plate steel column-free tower in Ginza, Tokyo, either end of the spectrum, one image making, the other structural engineering, absolute breakthroughs in their own disciplines within the within architecture and architectural culture, both collaborators alongside many others who, along with Mr. Ito, push that work to the limits the way they do so consistently. He is here tonight on the occasion of the First Works exhibition, which is on display in the gallery opposite. And he will be presenting his contribution to that show, which is a project from 1971 titled The Aluminum House, which in many ways that he'll present tonight was a literal grounding of metabolism and the discourse of 1960s Japanese architecture on the ground and in the form of a suburban house that was his first realized project. I think it's fair to say in this day and age that there are few masterpieces around, but we would all probably agree without hesitation that the Sendai Mediatheque is undoubtedly and universally a masterpiece of our time, a project realized in 2000, and one that for the better part of the decade of the 1990s became the focal point of a discourse on lightness, diagrammatic architectures, and a complete rethinking of the assumptions of modern architecture realized in remarkable built form by the office now almost exactly 10 years ago. In that conversation that we held, that Shin and I organized with the students in 2006, Toyo confessed to the deep and lasting impact of a visit that he made to this school in the early 1990s when he confronted the body of ideas and thinking, which remarkably was then the jumping off point for a huge body of work that still continues to this day within the studio. And I think more than anything, it's a testament to the way in which he organizes a remarkable office, not just always on the lookout for new ideas and new interests, but a way of organizing itself so that different projects and possibilities can come along and without being scripted in advance, emerge through the making of projects. Shin Egashira, Unit Master in Diploma Unit 11, will, for nearly the 20th year, be the voice of Mr. Ito here in the auditorium. They have a long and running relationship. Shin has worked with him, alongside him in lectures, not just here, but in many other venues around the world. Theirs is at a certain level a kind of private conversation. Shin will apologize for his translation initially, but we all know it's deeply understanding of both the sensibility and the ambition of the office. And please join me in welcoming Toyo Ito.
Thank you, Brett. Good evening. Thank you for inviting me. I'm sorry, I speak Japanese and Shin Egashira will translate to English. Egashira-san ni translation をお願いするのは多分90、91年からで、もう18年ぐらい経つんですけれども、その間に建築はまあかなり変わったんですが、英語の力は全く変わりませんので申し訳ありません。
I don't know how to translate. since 18 years ago, I've been translating Toyo Ito's lecture. There's lots of progress in his project, but I'd like to apologize for lack of English vocabulary comparison to evolution of the architectural vocabulary.
今回あちらのギャラリーで、私の一番最初のプロジェクト、アルミナムハウスというプロジェクトを展示していますので、まあ、このプロジェクトがどうしてあのようなものになったのかというお話から始めたいと思います。
Today's lecture I would like to start to illustrating background of during 60s to 70s in Tokyo in relationship, try to illustrate context in which aluminum house been evolved.
当時の日本の建築界の状況からお話したいと思うんですけれども、
So I'd like to start with kind of architectural climate of that period in Japan.
This is 1964. I was a student. And, this is Tokyo Olympic Games, just before the Olympic Games. And I visited the construction site of Kenzo Tange Stadium. この時期が日本の建築界にとっては、一つの、そのゴールデンエイジと言われている時代です。
Perhaps this year, particularly symbolized by Olympic, it could be called as golden age of growth of Tokyo as a city.
ちょうど今の中国のような状況でしたと。
Perhaps you could compare with the what's happening in China for last five years.
そして、メタボリストと呼ばれる建築家たちが、この前後に台頭してきました。
So there is a growing influence of metabolism movement at that period. So there are quite few leading architects came out from that period.
で、65年から69年まで私はメタボリストの一人である、菊竹清則という建築家の働きました。
So I began to work for 清則菊竹、it's my association with his office. It stands from 1965 to 1969.
これは多分、24歳の時だと思います。
Perhaps as I remember I was 24 years old in this photograph. 4 years old.
Okay, next please. で、当時菊竹清則氏は、このような非常に実験的な建築を作っていました。
You see in these images, 清則菊竹 have a very experimental practice to generating various formal expressions structurally as well as its size.
このプロジェクトは、アーキグラムにも影響を及ぼしたプロジェクトですけれども、このような実験的なプロジェクトがその公共建築として実現できた時代でした。
It's also, as perhaps some of us know, that there is huge influence to archigram movement that period, such works by Kikutake's work. But at the same time, we have to know that the economical condition as well as climate of urban construction in Tokyo enable make this type of buildings possible.
Next.そして昨年亡くなった岸尾黒川さんは、これ70年代の初めですけれども、 このようなカプセルタワーを作っていました。最もそのメタボリズムらしいプロジェクトということができると思います。
So other leading architect we just lost last year was Kisho Kurokawa who did this capsule tower buildings and also symbolizes metabolism during that period in early 70s。
しかし、まあ、60年代の後半には、まあ、激しい学生運動が、大学紛争が起こりました。
So at the same time, during the late 60s, there is another movement, probably more to do with political ideology of student revolution started from late 60s.
Next.そして、この70年という年は日本の現代建築にとって非常に大きな意味を持った年だと思います。
So from my vision, it's 1970s. It's a very important turning point of growth of the city of Tokyo.
つまり大阪で、Expo 70が行われたわけですけれども、まあ、この時すでにその未来への夢が、まあ、崩れ落ちようとしていました。
Perhaps those technological utopian visions evolved during late or towards late 60s at the same time as being put onto the period during the 70s World Exposition.
この写真では写っておりませんけれども、この手前の方に2つのロボットがありました。磯崎さんによってデザインされたものです。
In this image, doesn't capture, but in fact there was a robot designed by Arata Isozaki. It's just outside the frame of this picture.
しかし日本のカントリーサイドからやってきた人たちは、皆さんこの岡本太郎の作ったキッチと言われているこの太陽の塔の前で写真を撮りました。
But, we experienced most of people came from provincial area in Japan. Majority is taking most of the photograph of this rather kitsch symbolic sculpture made by Taro Okamoto. Almost overshadowed the robot designed by Isozaki.
つまり60年代にはその未来都市、未来の都市をの夢を描くということと、そのアバンギャルドであるということとは、まあ、完全にオーバーラップしていたわけですけれども、この大学紛争とともにその2つの方向が完全に外れてしまったというか、合わなくなってしまったということができます。
So futuristic technological utopian visions it's integrated by various form of architectural experiments during 1960s is actually confronted by or encountered by political ideology of student movement that has begun in late 60s.
まあ、この時期に私はまあ大学に戻ろうと思っていたんですけれども、大学は封鎖されてしまいまして、自分で自分の仕事のオフィスを、小さなオフィスを作らざるを得ないという状況になりました。
So right after this exposition I wanted to go back to university to study again, but in fact a result of student revolutions for entire university has been closedSo there is no choice but starting its own practice in small office, Tokyo.
まあこれは同じそのExpo 70のために菊竹清則氏がデザインしたタワーです。
So this tower has been designed by 清則菊竹 in 1970s.
まあこの初期に私はこのプロジェクトに関わっていたんですけれども、まあその時にはまあこのタワーにはこのようなカプセルがもう山のようにたくさんついていたんですが、実際に実現したのはわずか5つのカプセルだけでした。
So I was involving in the earlier stage of design this tower, and earlier schemes have a full of capsule attached to this tower, but resulting on only 5 small capsules, as you see on this photograph.
そして、ちょうどその同じ時期に和夫篠原が、まあ、非常に内向的なプロジェクトによって登場してきました。
At the same time, there's another influential architects came out from this period who are not so much related to metabolism. His name is Shinohara, Kazuo Shinohara.
この今の写真は66年に実現した白の家という篠原和夫の代表作です。
So one of his exemplary buildings or house is called House in White, built in 1966.
彼はその都市に背を向け、その非常に内向をするということ、そして抽象化の度合いを高めるということ、そして、できるだけ要素を取り去ってミニマルにしていくということによって、そのメタボリスムたちのプロジェクトとは全く逆の方向でデビューしたわけです。
In contrast to metabolist agenda, his architectures focuses on rather isolations or separations, interiority and abstractions.And also minimalist composition, seek for isolated space.
このプロジェクトを見ていただくとよくわかりますけれども、正方形の中に真ん中に一本柱があって、そこから外れたところに一本のラインを引くというその、それだけでこの住宅は成り立っています。
For instance, this plan is simply explain square forms and one column right in the middle.And off-centered one straight lines. It's actually compositions to divide the rooms very, very simply.
そして我々のジェネレーションの建築家たちは、ちょうど70年を境に、このような内側にしか夢はない、都市に向かっては夢はないという、このイデオログに影響を大きな影響を受けたわけです。
So such work of Shinohara influenced our generation of that time, the young architects. We are beginning to look into realization of personal utopian views realized within the interior.
いまだに日本の建築家たちはこのような抽象化、それからミニマルな方向、そして内側に閉じた傾向から抜け出ることができないでいると思います。
Perhaps that tendency of notion of the isolated space, abstractions, and minimal form still can be recognized in current architectural practice in Tokyo.
Okay, next. ちょうどそんな時期にこのアルミナムハウスというプロジェクトは生まれました。
So actually, aluminum houses came out during this period of transition.
ですから、私の中でこの作品は非常に複雑なさまざまな感情がミックスされた建築です。
So to me, this building not only represents its functionalities or building appearance, but it's also lots of personal agenda as well as confusions inherited from metabolist influenced up to new changes in terms of sense of value.
この煙突のような不思議な形をしたこの形は私にとってはこれはカプセルなんです。
To me, this rather chimney-like form unit is, to me, it represents capsule.
Next. Next.黒川氏や菊武さんのように空中で輝いているカプセルではなくて地上にそれらが落ちた廃墟のようなカプセルでした。
To me, this capsule is the falling off capsule from the tower of 黒川を菊武 falling off the ground, landed on the ground. It shows the end of metabolism, but same time the beginning of new architecture.
Okay, next.このここでは一つの住居を示していますけれども、当初のプロジェクトはあちらのギャラリーのドローイングのところに見られるように4つのそのカプセルがここについていました。
So in this plan, the plan of the house, but probably in prototype stage, as you see on the main gallery, these are consist on four individual units clustered together.
予算が合わなくて、2つに組み合わされてしまいました。
Then budget ran out, so it ended up become two towers.
Okay, next. 内部はこのように上から光が落ちてくる筒の下にこのベッドルームがあるというような内部は木で覆われておりました。
So interior clad by timber, it shows the interiority which a small light came from light there on the top, beneath which there is a bed. Sleeping space being situated.
そして、先ほどご覧いただいたように、その外側は非常に薄いアルミで、何かその薄さ、光に当たって、貧しく光っているような、そういう何か貧しさを象徴していました。
Also, the outside being clouded by very, very thin aluminum cladding, which emphasizes rather ephemerality. Or non-symbolic or non-heroic view of sensitivity of this capsule in comparison to capsule from metabolism, which tend to be heroic buildings. So this rather lead into sleeping platforms.
Next. これがベッドルームでした。
The bedroom.
その時に雑誌で特集されたタイトルがアーバンロボットというタイトルで、これが私のオフィスの初期の名前となりました。
So it says on the Urban Robot on the top was the main title for first publication during the magazine during this period. Equally, this Urban Robot became the name of my office.
Next.
Practice in Tokyo.
その時、私は30歳だったんですけれども、この後ろにちょっとご覧になりにくいかもしれませんが、オフィスの壁に貼ってあったのはEasyライダーのポスターです。
As you see, it's 1971. I was 30 years old. This office background is a poster. You see on the obscured my figure. It's a poster from EasyRider.
そして、その地上に転が落ちているカプセルという、一人のためのカプセルというプロジェクトです。
So this collage shows the series of capsules falling off to the ground, which only room for minimum functions of isolation and light, catered for only one body of the person.
この中に、カプセルが、例えば4つ、これはそれぞれ、1つの住宅を形成していても、結局は個人でしかないというような、ペシミスティックな状況を示しています。
So this model also emphasizes the notion of individual within the collective notion of the house. House no longer become house, it's only collection of individual unit, like bed and light bulb.
そして、翌年1972年に、和尾篠原が審査員をしたアイデアコンペで、同じようなプロジェクトを提案して、これはオナラリベンションでしたね。
So in 1972 we enter this competitions judged by Kazuo Shinohara and as a result this project which represents urban robot it's been having honorable mentions.
ここに書かれた文章はどんなに閉ざされても、まだ一人に、まだ閉ざされきれないというか、閉ざしさが不足しているといったようなモノローグがここに書かれています。 Sorry.
In the text, struggle to explain on this text is about notion of isolations and frustrations not being able to create absolute isolations within notions of collective enclosure.
Okay, next. またもう一つのホワイトユーというプロジェクトになって、実現したのが1976年、4年後です。
4 years later, this project called White You, which are also continuation of similar ideas and concept realized in different forms.
まあこのプロジェクトもすごくその環境に対して、閉ざされていて、そして、その光だけが、まあ、テーマになっています。
So in a way, similarity to aluminum house is try to enclose the space against existing environment and functions reducing down. So there's every functionality is being stripped off, comes down to the either idea of enclosedness, separations, also emphasized by volume of the light, which came from a small aperture.
Yes. まあこの真ん中のその何もないそのコートヤードをの周辺をいつもそのこの家族たちは回っているとサーキュレートしているというようなまあ住宅でした。
So it's semi-circular courtyard surrounded by space. Although it's been separated by concrete wall, whole lifestyle has been encircled around this emptiness of the house.
ですから今、まあ、私は大体まあこのプロジェクトから語り始めることが多いんですけれども、まあ今の説明で、まあ、非常にこう複雑ではあるんですが、私の60年代から70年代へかけてのこの10年間、の、まあ感情の推移といいますか気持ちの変遷を、まあ、読み取っていただければ幸せです。その一見アルミの家とこのホワイトユーとは随分その表現は違っているんですけれども、そこにはある連続した思いがあります。
So normally, every time I give a lecture which often start from this white you project we didn't have much chance to explain those transformation of the ideas from earlier projects. So although it's either personal or emotional notions of those space, it's very, very difficult to explain, but I would appreciate that if you share this context from late 60s to up to white U project that's been shown here.
Thanks.まあ、ですからこのプロジェクトある意味で私の中でも、まあ、美しいという点で言えば最も美しいものに入るかもしれないんですけれども、まあ、最もその、パーソナルというか、社会性のないプロジェクトということもできると思います。
On one hand, I would, explainAesthetic and spatial expression, which I'm very, very proud of these buildings. But at the same time, this project could explain probably non-association to any social context as a piece of architecture, as a characteristic of this building.
まあそのことが、まあ、私にとってこの住宅を実現して以降、まあ、すごくその気にかかるようになりました。
Also, although it was intentional, but a neglect of social context became another issue after completion of this white, white.
まあ建築家として一人の建築家としてどうやって社会との関係をもう一回取り戻すことができるのかということは、まあ今でもこれ以後私のテーマとして続いています。
So continuing my agenda is how, as individual architects, maintain certain.Set of relationship, either critically or theoretically, in relationship to community or society or social context, to be addressed individual architects within.
Okay. で、まあそんなこと試行錯誤がいろいろあったわけですけれども、1980年代に入って、まあ自分をどうしたら変えられるだろうかということを考え始めました。
So it takes a while, but up to the early 80s, but another agenda has become how to regain this social awareness or social context through the practice.
なかなかその自分を変えるというのは実際には難しいことなので、ここでは、ドミノというタイトルで、フレームだけをデザインすると、そして、このフレームを買ってくれる人がいれば、その内部のプランニングあるいは素材マテリアル等はそのクライアントの要望に合わせますという、パンフレットを作って、その一般の女性向けの雑誌に掲載をして応募する人を募りました。
This is extract from lifestyle magazine widely available for ordinary people. So what we did is advertise this only frame structures seeking for the client.Would like to buy this very, very minimum structures to be able to customize as they build or design further.
そして、非常にたくさんのそのクライアントが集まることを期待していたんですが、実際にはたった一人でした。
So、we were expecting to have lots of people applying or contact, but in fact, there's only one person return to our.Advertisement.
Next. 一件だけ、実現したわけです。
But it's been built.
Next. しかしこのプロジェクトをやることによって、自分はもう少しこう心に精神的にゆとりができたような気がしました。
But it's actually this project itself become enormous emotional support for me as an architect.
そして同じ時期に花小金井の住宅という住宅を作りましたが、これは瀬島和代さんの実家です。
So same period, we built this house in 花小金井 in similar concept. This house actually is the house belonged to parents of 和代瀬島。
ちょうどこの時期に彼女は我々のオフィスで働くようになりまして。彼女が担当して自分の家を伊藤事務所で作ったわけです。
So as you know that Kazuyo Sejima was the staff in the my office during that period, so she came and worked with us and complete house for her parents.
今もこの住宅は存在しています。
So、this house is still well maintained and lived today.
Next.そして、この花小金井の家をさらにのコンセプトをさらに展開したものが私の自邸、シルバーハットです。
So then, reading from this domino ideas to previous building types and the resulting most important building is Silver Hat, as you see in this photograph.
このホワイトユーとこのシルバーハットは連続した敷地にありましたけれども、非常にコントラストを成しています。
So、as you see the 8 years gap between white U to a silver hat, it shows its contrast of changes during the 8 years of gap, which you could see in this photograph. As they stand right next to each other.
ホワイト U は、ほとんど内部しかないような家でしたけれども、シルバーハットはどこまで行っても外しかないような家でした。
So the contrast means enclosedness of white U, which only consists of enclosure. There's no escape to the outside. In contrast to that, white silver hat is perhaps more difficult to find interiority, so enclosed space as buildings kept inviting people going outside from their its composition.
スチールを使って、非常に軽い軽いストラクチャーを実現したいと考えていました。
Also technically, lightweight steel constructions, which emphasize the lightness of the building.
日本の伝統的な建築が持っている仮設性をここで新しい形で実現したいと考えたわけです。
So、other ambition of the structural ambition is try to revisit ideas of temporality learned from traditional timber construction in Japan, but translate into lightweight steel structural component.
まあ、ちょうどこの時期にあのケネス・クラントンさんがインタビューしたムービーがありますのでほんの少しですけれどもご覧いただきたいと思います。
I would like to show also video clip interviewed by Kenneth Frampton who visited this house that time.
Next to his sister's U-shaped house in Tokyo's Nakano district stands Ito's own silver hut, a work of exceptional complexity. At first encounter, it may be read as being based on a traditional Japanese nine-square plan. The concrete columns not only frame the solid and perforated light metal screens of the enclosure, but also support the open latticework vaults that define but do not fully enclose the central court. At the same time, one may interpret this courtyard house as a kind of science fiction synthesis of the Mediterranean atrium and the Bedouin tent.
でその時にその東京を見ましてみると
closer and closer to the same kind of lightweight extraordinary ordinary machine made architecture exploiting again asphalt materials aluminum sheet metal perforated metal again and geodesic tetrahedron construction somewhat like the early pioneering work of Buckminster Fuller and it's interesting to you know that he is sort of reinterpreting the Southeast Asian basic dwelling you know in modern asphalt technological terms
Although the U-shaped house and the silver hut are next door to each other, they represent a 10-year process in the evolution of my thinking. Japanese houses are like an empty stage in a theater. You bring in some furniture to create a scene. The furniture suggests the interaction of people on a stage set.
There is a connection between Ito's theatrical spaces and the traditional tea house concept in which the enclosure was seen as being brought to life through the ritual itself.
In this house, I covered the furniture with a thin veil to express the impermanence and theatrical aspects of this architecture. My idea is to search in the forest of the city for unusual but ordinary materials and use them in my architecture.That's one of my main interests.
In this ventilator tower built outside Yokohama Station, a perforated aluminum cylindrical screen breaks up at night into an expressive cascade of sparkling lights.
まあちょうどその80年代のまああの半ばから90年代のおよそ10年間はまた新たなバブルエコノミーと言われた東京が大変まあ華やかな時代でした。
So、following to beginning of 1990s, probably Japanese economies can be described as the bubbly period of economical growth.
そしてこれはまあその当時の都市の印象をあのインスタレーションにしたもので91年にあのビクトリアン・アルバート・ミュージアムで行われたものです。
So this image is taken from installations built in 1991 in Victorian Albert Museum.
私にとってはまあ建築もその実態リアルさが失われて、全てが、まあ、映像を見ているようなそんな時代でした。
So, my image of the Tokyo at that time is, as the city begins to abstract the sense of reality, illuminated by flood of images and lights and informations, flooded into all entire city landscape.
まあ、そんな時代にデザインされてわずか2年間で亡くなったレストランの窓です。
So this period also did this restaurant called Restaurant Nomad. It's only existed for 2 years.
Next. 東京ノマドウーマンのためのパオというプロジェクトです。
Urban dwelling for Tokyo Nomad Women called PAO.
まあ都市あの住宅の機能が全て都市に流出していって、住宅というのはもうその抜け殻のようなものでしかないという。
So, idea is how the domesticity or notion of the house is dissolved into urban environment, but left is just element.
We
designed three component furniture, as you see Kazuyo Sejima using one of the furniture in this photograph.
Next.
You see this is the wind tower in Yokohama, Tower of Wind.
Next. そしてまあそのようなイメージ軽くて、まあ透明な実体感のない、まあそんな建築のイメージがまあようやく91年に、公共建築として、実現しました。
So those fascination about image of architecture as lightness and ephemerality suddenly become a reality.During this period of early 90s, built upon this public building project.
まあこのプロジェクトからスタートして90年代はまあ公共の仕事に少しずつシフトしていくことになります。
So actually, they are practicing a project during 90s. It could be also explained as.Transition from smaller scale to larger scale, or more public buildings, from either small Next. Temporary building to larger projects.
Next. そして、1995年に Sendai Mediatheque のコンペティションがありまして、まあ、2001年にオープンすることになります。
So, Sendai Mediatheque competition started from 1995 and ended up.Taking 6 years to complete in 2001.
まあこの6年間はなかなかまあ困難な戦いがありましたけれども、まあオープンして2001年にオープンした時には人々がまあ非常にこの建築を受け入れてくれた。まあそのことが私にとってはまあ大きな勇気となりました。
Although confronted by so many difficulties during the period of realizations, but at the same time after there's been completions of the buildings, it's also proved that there is lots of association with the local community up to also the way in which this urban space been utilized as a part of the space.
そのプロジェクトがオープンした時に私は初めて自分が、まあ、日本の建築家として社会の中にいる社会の中の存在であるということを実感した瞬間でした。
So this is the completion is also the first time in my architectural career to feel that it's actually part of the context in the city as well as the theory and the technical context as well. Technological context.
そしてちょうど同じ時期から、まあ、ヨーロッパの社会で、少しずつ建築を作り始めることが可能になりました。
Also, another change is in the practice. It began to be given more opportunity to build certain projects outside Japan, namely Europe.
まあ、ヨーロッパにいると、まあ、建築家が、まあ、非常に若い仕事のない人でも社会の中の存在であるということは、まあ、常識になっているような気がしまして、まあ、それもまた私にとっては大きな勇気を与えてくれました。
Also, European architectural world seems to enable giving some opportunity for younger architects, although they don't have much practice.But they are also integrated or invited to be a part of making the city public, which I find is very encouraging.
まあこの小さなパビリオンも1年でなくなる予定でしたけれども、まああの市民の人たちがまあこれを残しておこうという運動を起こしてくれて、今も健在です。
Thanks to the local commitment, this building is actually meant to be stand for only for a year.But now it remains because of the demand from the community around this area.
まあこのプロジェクトは皆さんの中にもご存知の方多いかもしれませんけれども、まあこのプロジェクトもまああのロンドンの人たちが本当にこう楽しんでくださるという姿を見て、 大変まあ自分のその表現の問題以上に、まあそのことがとても自分には感動的でした。
Perhaps some of you actually remember this structure stands in the Serpentine Pavilion, but its encouragement I have from seeing this space or building project, it's more to do with how people actually utilize those spaces in the given context.
まああのここまでがまあ私のその建築のヒストリーといいますか、非常にまああの、簡単に、あの、説明させていただきましたけれども、ここから先はですね、あの、少し最近のプロジェクトを 2,3 ご紹介します。
So I would like to end my personal history description in here, but from now on, I would like to focus on my new practice project.
Next.
More recent project.
これはもう間もなく3年前になりますが、東京の郊外の美術大学の図書館のプロジェクトです。
It's already took 3 years since it's been completed, but these are university facilities stands outskirts of Tokyo.
Next. ご覧のように、まあ、アーチ、いろんなそのスパンのアーチの連続体で、できています。
Its structural organization consists on very thin, lightweight arch structures in differentproportion.
そして、すべてのこの、まあ、ある種のこれグリッドでできているんですけれども、そのグリッドはほとんど極緩い曲線の交差によってできています。
Basically, there's a grid that's been used for the plan organization, but in fact, this grid itself has been gently curved to enable have differences.
Next. そしてご覧のように、まあ、大変薄いその壁でできていますけれども、これはまあ構造に、まあ、特別な工法をエンジニアが提案してくれまして、このように薄くかつあの足元が非常に細いアーチが実現しました。
So one of the structural experimentation is to try to achieve the thinness of this arched wallwall structures, at the same time thinness of the columns on the bottom, enabled by reinvention of composite structures, steel plates actually sandwiched by very thin concrete layers in both sides.
まあこの中央にスチールプレートで作ったアーチが挟ま、あのコンクリートに挟まれて、存在しています。あ、はい。OK. Next.まあ、非常にあの施工が素晴らしかったということもあります。
Also, this quality is quite low in terms of the quality of the constructions.
まあ自分ではそのソフィスティケートするような方向に行かないようにということをいつも気をつけてはいるんですけれども、日本で物を作っていると、まあ、非常にその施工の素晴らしさによって、まあ、どうしてもそれに頼ってしまう、まあ、そのことはいつも非常に警戒しています。
At the same time, during my practices, I always try to avoid over sophisticated finishes of the quality of the buildings, but such industry in Japan, it's often very, very difficult not to depend upon the quality being achieved by civil engineer construction.
まあ、そこに頼っていると他の国へ海外へ行った時に、その建築が成立しないのではないかというような心配がいつもあります。
Otherwise, there might be an anxiety if you are so used to this quality guaranteed in Japan. Perhaps you may having very difficult time in abroad if you work with different industry.
Next.Next. もう一つの特徴はこの1階グランドレベルが緩い勾配、床が緩い勾配、まあ、敷地に合わせて20分の1の勾配を持っているということです。
So Another characteristic of this building is emphasized by ground level floor, which is actually sloping gently in the ratio of 1 to 20 in response to the given topography of the area.
今映っている部分は自由に通り抜けていけるようなフリースペースになっておりまして、学生たちがここで、ギャラリーに使ったり、カフェになったり、あるいは小さなレクチャー等が行われています。
So this open space have free access and also flexibilities of having certain event such as lectures, gathering, all sort of event become possible.
Next. これは同じグランドレベルの手前がオーディオビジュアルのスペース。そして向こう側に見えるのが雑誌を見るカウンターです。
So interior of the library, this image shows there in front is audio-visual booth enabled by position of the furniture leading into the backside, which are reading sections.
Next. まあさまざまな姿勢で、その映像を見たり本を読めるようにということに、配慮しました。
Also, body position according to attitudes towards information, how you read.How you position yourself, this furniture's arrangement enables to have various body kind of positions.
まあこの家具は藤江和子さんという、まあこの大学で、ゲストプロフェッサーをしている方のデザインです。
These furniture is designed by Kazuko Fujie, who's also professor in this university.
Next. これは、その雑誌のコーナーですね。
そうそう、マガジンセクションズ in the library.
Next. 2階はフラットな床ですけれども、こちらはの大半の部分は開花のライブラリーになっています。
So then upper floor, first floor of the library is consists on these bookshelves contain certain collection of the books to be read.Publicly.
Next. まあ比較的その書架を低くしまして、空間全体が流れていくようにと流動性を高めるように配慮しました。
Also, position of the bookshelves is tend to be kept at as low as possible in order to contrast space above and space below.
Next. 次は今年オープンしたばかりの東京の都心にある小さなシアターコンプレックスです。
The next project is most recent project, the theater situated in the in Tokyo.
Next. これはイワンさんの写真ですけれども、イワン・バーンソンの写真ですけれども、ここにプロジェクトがあります。
This photograph by Mr. Ian Barn. You see that black squareish building is on the corner.
まあ、ご覧のようにここ鉄道が走っていまして、ここには非常に幹線の道路がありまして、まあ、周辺も大変まあ、混み合った場所ですので、まあ、全体をかなり閉ざしました。外に対しては閉ざしました。
So in relationship to proximity to the railway runs proximity to this site.And also traffic moving on sideways at the intersection. So in a way, this theater space required to have certain level of enclosure against the noise.
まあここでもその外側は鉄板に覆われておりまして、この小さな円形の開口しかないんですけれども、内側にはコンクリートが。打たれていまして、鉄とコンクリートのここでも組み合わせになっています。
So these composite structures are outside skins made by steel plate and interior skins being cast by concrete.
Yes. まあ非常に外に対して開口はないんですけれども、まあ60年代の70年代の作品とは違って、まあ、建築の中と外とはかなり一体的に作られています。
Although maybe if you compare with the earlier project about enclosures This example seems to have its own enclosure, but at the same time, maybe successful display building is also tend to open up to the surrounding environment.
この写真でちょっと分かりにくいんですけれども、左側にメインエントランスがあって、右側にはあの物販の搬出入口があるんですけれども、これらが一体になって、外と中とを連続させています。
So, probably this photograph is a bit difficult to see the position of main entrance on the left-hand side, and right-hand side is also entrance for the all those set and large materials in and out, but those two openings enable to circulate people as well as objects.
Next. Space the, これはエントランスホールです。
エントランスホールビュー。
ここには地上に一つの劇場がありまして、地下に二つの劇場があります。
So on the ground level, it's one larger theater complex combined with two theater and auditorium.Located in basement level.
Next. この階段によって、全ての、機能が結ばれています。
And this main staircase integrate all those three theater complex together.
Next. Next. これが地上の劇場で、なかなかその映像でうまく伝えることができないんですけれども、実際には、このシアターは非常にフレキシブルなステージをどこに置いても演出が可能な非常にフレキシビリティの高い劇場です。
So、this ground level theater shows one configuration of performing space, but actually this space is very, very flexible, positioned theater and positioned audience.
したがって、ここはそのプロの演出家たちが使えるような劇場で、この下にもう一つ同じような、250から300席ぐらいの劇場があるんですが、そちらはその一般の市民が簡単に利用ができる、2つが組み合わされて、この劇場が成立しています。
So, ground level theaters also responds to more professional users.Then at the same time, basement level theater, which tend to be small as 250 or 300 people as the audience size, but combined between these two volume of spaces, the type of volumes which enable to make complex spatial organization.
さらに3つ目のシアターが、この映像なんですけれども、ここはその、このエリアで毎年行われるダンス、独特のダンスのための練習、リハーサルルームを兼ねているわけです。
So then also third theater in the basement also associated with already existing performance activities related to the local area for practicing performance and dance as well.
Okay, next. そして、2005年から台湾で、オペラハウスのプロジェクトを継続しているんですが、ようやく今月工事が始まることになりました。
So, Opera House project in Taiwan began in 2005 as a result of competition, and it's fortunate that this construction begin this month.
Next. これは最終形ですね。一番新しい形です。
It's the final rendering of their project.
Next. これが構造体です。
It's the structural, component.
コンクリートで、全ての構造体を作ります。
It's, concrete, structure.
大変複雑なように見えますけれども、もともとは原理は比較的単純です。
Although it looks very complicated, but its actual principle is very, very simple.
これが最もそのシンプルな原理を示すもので、2枚のプレートの間をご覧のように、結んでいくと3次元の、連続、曲面の連続体ができまして、それによってこう AB という2つの空間に分岐されます。
So these simple models actually exemplify those principles which by stretched surface in between two plates forming minimum surfaceBeing dividing two volume of spaces, as well as being possibly being connected.
Next. それを上下に2回繰り返すと、まあ、ご覧のように水平方向にも垂直方向にも連続するチューブの連続体が出来上がります。
Then if you repeat this pattern twice, then you have a continuations and divisions both horizontally and vertically.
Next. それをプログラムに合わせて、まあ、変形をさせていきますが、まあ、ここには2000席の、グランドシアター、そして、800席のプレイハウスと呼ばれる中劇場、そして地下にブラックボックスという200席の実験劇場という3つの劇場が収められます。
Then a requirement of those three volumetric requirement for larger theaters, medium-sized theaters.And experimental theaters, each volume is being allocated, negotiating those structural principles.
Next. グランドレベルは、まあ、外のランドスケープがそのまま中まで入り込んでいるようなものになると思います。
Then grand level, it's try to let surrounding landscape slip into this auditorium space, emphasize the continuity.
これも同じグランドレベルですね。
Also grand level entrance lobby.
Next. そして5階のこれはイベントスペースです。
Event space on the fifth floor.
まあまあ1階を中心にしてこの壁面には、台湾のアーティストに壁画を描いてもらおうと思っています。
So also these walls.We are planning to commission Taiwanese artists to cover this wall with paintings.
Next. これがグランドシアターのイメージです。
It's a rendering interior view of grand level theater.
Next. Playhouse のイメージですね。
The playhouse.
Next. 屋上の庭園です。
And also a roof terrace garden.
そしてこれをどのように作っていくかということですけれども、全体が、まあ、ご覧のような色別のブロック、56のカテノイズと呼ばれているブロックに分かれます。
And also another challenge is to think of how this can be constructed. These each colored component, which divided back into 56 pieces to compose entire structures from those units.
Next. で、それぞれのブロックですけれども、これはトラスウォール工法という工法ですけれども、二次元の垂直方向のトラスを、まあ、20センチ間隔で、並べていくと、それぞれ少しずつ形態が変わっていくわけですが。
It's a truss wall construction method. The vertical unit is being divided in every 20 centimeter intervals, and those differentiations being combined together to describe continuous surface.
そして、その両サイドに、3枚ずつのメッシュを貼りまして、その間にコンクリートを流そうというわけです。
Then this primal, layers been sandwiched by three layers of mesh from both sides. Those cavities meant to be filled by concrete.
Next. これはすでに台湾で作られたモックアップですけれども、ほとんどすべての部分が40センチの厚さのコンクリートで実現する予定です。
This is a testing mock-up scale 1:1 constructed in Taiwan.It showed the continuous thickness of 40 centimeter walls. It consists on the lower part to upper part.
Okay. まああと3年ぐらいかかると思います。
It may take another 3 years to complete.
Next. また断面のムービーを見ていただきたいんですけれども、これは10センチごとに長手方向のセクションをカットして連続させたものです。
I would like to show the video to show the sections cut every interval of 10 centimeter as a continuous spatial
平面的にカットしても同じようなことが起こります。
It's also the same apply if you imagine their sections being cut horizontally.
Okay. Okay. 最後にもう一つだけ小さな一番新しいプロジェクトをご紹介したいと思います。
I would like to finish my lecture by showing this final project.
Next. まあこれはまあ日本の広島から近いんですけれども。小さな島に作られる私自身のミュージアムです。
This site is near Hiroshima. It's a little island. The program is a museum called Toyo Ito Museum. Little island.
実はそういう予定ではなくて、あるその。スポンサーに頼まれて、まあ、その人のためのミュージアムをデザインしていたんですが、いつの間にかお前のミュージアムにしろと言われて、そのようになることになりました。
So it wasn't my intention. This museum is called Toyo Ito Museum. There was a client and originally started off by designing museum for the client, but it's actually client start be involved in the Toyo Ito himself.Myself, itself. So now it's become Toyo Ito Museum, Architecture Museum.
そして、まあ、こちらがその部分で新たに作られる、まあ、こちらは展示を中心にしたもの、そして、こちらに私の先ほど紹介したシルバーハットを移設します。
So on the right hand side, show the new complex building, and on the left hand, right hand side, as you see, those silver hat, it's been relocated from Tokyo.Back to these small islands to form this museum as initial.
こちらはワークショップを中心にしたスペースです。
That space for Silver Heart is allocated for workshop activity.
Next. で、こちらもやはり鉄板で、覆われた構造体です。
This structure is similar to the previous project I showed, but it's also structurally consists on steel plate.
3つの多面体を組み合わせて、この幾何学が作られています。
So three different type of polyhedron plate structures combined together to make this multi complex volumes.
Next. まあ非常に住宅住宅レベルの小さな建築ですけれども、ここに5つ のスペースができまして、まあ、それらが、まあ、仙台ホワイトユー、そして、金作といったような、展示のスペースになると思います。
So, volume as a whole is not really big, but it's kind of a complex of a house scale volume of the buildingsCombined all together to exhibit certain conceptual ideas and documents of those white U houses and previous projects being shown earlier as part of this lecture.
Next. そしてこちらはシルバーハットをまあプログラムを変えまして、ここで私自身のアーカイブとそれからワークショップができるようなスペースに変えたいと思っています。
So this also interior view, it shows them reutilization of the silver hut into library spaces, workshop, utilities space, as well as archive and reading room.
Okay. まあ、来年いっぱいで建築ができる予定なんですけれども、 なぜこのようなものになったかと言いますと、私は従来から自分の残された人生の中で若い建築家を育てたいというふうに考えておりました。
One of the motivations why I'm showing this project is also I didn't realize that the importance of education of architects, especially in the contemporary architectural climate.
それがこのような形で実現するとは予想もしていなかったんですけれども、来年にはこの建築ができて、再来年2011年には前半のうちに、オープンすると思います。So
it wasn't my intention to propose this building, but in fact this chance came. Given some kind of educational program as well as educational architects, and hoping for the new stage of this museum turn into educational facility, which I expected to be open in 2011.
まあ、 ぜひ皆さんもやってきて、一緒にワークショップをやりましょう。
So please join us for this workshop after 2011 to do some architectural workshop all together.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Quickly, maybe we should move to, there might be lots of questions. I'm not so sure how well I can translate. If you can ask in Japanese, it would be very, very good. But any language, I think, as long as I can translate. Does anyone have questions or comments?
Toyo, one comment about the 1960s and 1970s, which you showed the interior of the U house and the concrete, the white U house. And it reminded me very much of the many Japanese architects of the time in the 60s who were turning internally. You know Miyawaki, mm-hmm. and the architects group, and the house like a die. Propositions of architecture which were turning against the city and building concrete boxes. So you didn't mention them, but you mentioned Shinohara, but there were many other architects in Japan as strong as the metabolist group who were also producing inward anti-urban statements in a very very polluted environment. I just wonder. That's just a comment. But I have a question about your this wonderful new domino block that you're using. And it strikes me the minimal surface is a fantastic idea, conceptually. And you've applied it two or three times. But it grows out of work of the Sendai, because in a way, the interiors get bigger, the columns get bigger and bigger and bigger, and soon they take over the floor and the wall. So in a way, from Sendai to these, the later work, is like the work of Zaha Hadid at Wolfsburg, and like a lot of work that is coming, which tries to make a combination of the vertical structure and circulation and space. And it ends up in a kind of contradiction, because it's very hard to move laterally through walls, and very hard to put interconnections, very hard to put windows, very hard to put. So it looks like it's a problem, of a functional problem. And I wonder if you have anything to say about this new domino block of architecture in terms of its function. If its usability, is it a difficulty? I domino like Le Corbusier. He's proposing a new.
その最近の、あの、台湾の方の、その、
First of all, thank you, Jenks. あの最初のコメントに対しては、まあ、あの例えば安藤忠雄さんも私のホワイトユーと同じ時代にあの住吉の長屋という時代、まあ、彼も非常にあの外に対して閉ざしておりました。で、まあ、それをもう一回どうやってこう開いていくかということが私にとっては、まあ、非常に大きなテーマとなって、まあ、その後のさまざまな試みにつながっているということをもう一度まあ申し上げたいと思います。
So as referred to earlier comment, there are, apart from Miyawaki and also Tadawando had a signature project in Sumiyoshi's dwelling. So in a way, I would like to restate my ambitions during that period is how to restart opening up those enclosed space from 70s to through the mid-70s project.
そしてその2番目の質問に対してですけれども、まあ、これはおっしゃる通りで、まあ、自分の建築が表現的になってはまずいだろうということはいつも今しめるようにしています。
Also, response to the last half of the comment. As an architect, probably most important thing is try not to rely upon symbolism of the structural scale at the same time complexity. That kind of personal dilemma when the structure becomes bigger and more expressive.
まあ、あのプロジェクト、台湾のプロジェクトは、アラップのセシル・バルマンと一緒に、ストラクチャー、のデザインをお願いしてやっているわけですけれども、まあ、ストラクチャー自体から言えばできるだけ水平方向の部分が少ない方が構造的にはもちろん有利なわけです。
So, this structural design is being done in collaboration with Cecil Barman from Overlock. And from the structural reason, probably it's more efficient to have a vertical oriented surface as opposed to horizontal distributions of this continuous concrete unit.
しかし、まあ、うまく使うためにはできるだけ水平部分が多い方がいい。
But in terms of circulation and spatial usage, of course, horizontal surface will be more valuable than vertically located surface.
まあ、このことは建築を作るときに非常にいつも問題になることです。
Probably not only exemplify this project, but any architectural project.
つまり、
it's always confronted by this contradiction between structural requirement and also efficiency of the horizontal surface.
まあ、言い換えると、有機的な形態を作ろうとするときに、最後に問題になるのはいつも床なんです。
Maybe in short, probably always the fundamental problem when you're pursuing the organic architecture, then always flow becomes a problem.
まあ、ですから、そのことは、まあ、今の、チャールズ・ジェンクスさんの、まあ、疑問をそのまま自分で受け止めて、まあ、そこをどのようにその調和していくか。ということをこれからも考えなくてはいけないという課題だと思っています。
So in response to comment and questions, I really accept those sharing similar concern to Mr. Jenks and try to reflect or keep challenging these notions of flow surface in relationship to geometry.
ただ、まあ、私はその20世紀を支配したその民主的なグリッドが、まあ、人間までもすごくその均質化しているという現実に対してもう少し何か人間がもっとその動物的になりうるようなそういう空間を求めたいというそこから走っているのであって、まあ、先ほども申したように、ただその何かシンボリックに3次元の表現をしたいと思っているわけではありません。
So the notion of organic forms not derived from fascination about its, what kind of symbols it represents, but more to do this question towards a Mithraean grid which dominates the 20th century architecture, but how to translate different typology of the geometry which enables to have differences and the aggregation of different organizations become possible. So that necessarily symbolized through the buildings, but at the same time maybe more equally interesting to challenge special organization that became possible by structural solution. Then, which probably the challenge means flow surface distribution in relationship to structure is the actual fundamental challenge and project problem which like further experiment challenge.
Any other question?
I think it's interesting that the lecture was not given in English but in Japanese. How important do you think the Japanese language of space is in your work, room, space, these types of terminologies?
For me, very important. Of course, yeah. というのは、その多分その、まあ、maybe Shin is so difficult to translate my Japanese. というのは、まあ、分かりやすく言うと、その日本語というのは、まあ、できるだけその一つ一つの言葉の意味を曖昧にしておきたいという、そういう願望を込めた言葉だと思います。
Probably one of the difficulty to look at the structure of the language, but more so in terms of the intention of the language. Japanese language is an expression of not wanting to articulate precise definitions, so try to remain each word left ambiguous. So that's the kind of language structure enabled to communicate level of ambiguity.
まあ、それが英語に翻訳されるときにできるだけクリアにそれを表現しなくてはならないという矛盾があるんだろうと思います。
So contradiction is some level of definitions English language expect. So when it's been translated or when it's trying to express through in Japanese language, there are also fundamental dichotomy between two different languages.
もう少しそれを、まあ、分かりやすい例えにすると 僕はよくそのメタファーとして波紋をということを言いますとリプルスです
ね。As a metaphor, for example, to exemplify this difficulty, I often use the water ripple on the surface when things drops.
まあ水の中にいくつものこう石を投げたときにそれぞれこう波紋が広がっていってそれが相互に干渉し合って、まあ、連続していく、まあ、そんなイメージをいつも日本の言葉に持っています。
So, if you imagine surface of still water, but if you throw different sizes of stones into it, it could each one create different ripples.But when those are either synchronized or interfere together, and they become pattern, then Japanese language is kind of similar to the phenomena of interference with the surface as a kind of changing, simultaneous change of condition described by different words.
I would like to know which are, for you, the main challenges you think the next generation of architects are facing? And also, do you envy the next generation, or are you content with the generation you belong to?
Very difficult question. まあ、今日もお話ししたことなんですけれども、その私の建築は自分のそのフラストレーションとかコンプレックスとか、まあそういうことがどこかで根本にあると。で、何かそれは70年代に自分が身につけてしまった批評性という、何かを常にこう批評して、それに対して、こう批評ということが意味を持っているような建築を作ろうとしてきた。で、今はそれを変えたいと思ってるんです、自分では。そういう必要はもうないだろうと思ってるんだけれども、まあ、そのことは自分の身体にも身について、染み込んでいるかもしれない。で、そういうことのない世代の人たちが、まあ、その批評性という言葉を抜きにして新しく建築を考えることができたら、もっと素晴らしいことができるだろう、もっとはるかに素晴らしいことができるだろうと思っています。
So as I showed in the earlier 1960 to 70 context, so naturally something I learned is to be, as an architect, how you can be critical to the existing environment that immediately surrounds you. And those things are either personal or private emotionally or whatever it is, which I still feel that it's part of myself, although I would like to not to see myself being critical to the all those architectural environments surrounding us, both theoretically and architecturally as the building. But then something I would like to look for is if there is a generation which completely free from any kind of critical value to be able to practice architectural design to draw the new vision, which myself might not be able to do because those experiences of the 60s to 70s, those critical visions, it's already part of myself. But I would like to see the kind of new generation to be able to express those certain architectural visions free from any kind of critical criteria, which might be very, very new to me.
そうですね。
もうそういうソーシャルコンディション。
Yes, I am very interested in the Museum of Toyo Ito. And I was asking myself how does this structure translate your work throughout the years?Or how spatially expresses or resumes your work, and if it does.
Hi. まだそんなにその具体的にイメージできているわけではありませんけれども。何か、まあ、A スクールで行われているように学生さんたちと一緒に何かが作られて、それがまたその建築を変えていくような、まあ、そういうことができれば一番素晴らしいと思って、例えばその、理想的にはそのシルバーハットの部分は、躯体だけ構造体だけ作って、そこから何をその先に作っていくかっていうのは本当は一緒にそこにワークショップでやってきた人たちと一緒に考えられたら理想的だと思っています。
So at this moment still preliminary setting of the architectural elements in the museum itself, but in the future most ideally how the building itself begin to transform at the extent or as a result of workshop or some sort of then we begin to see similar example in some activity within the AA itself. So in the future, probably very, very exciting to see how structural component of silver hat start transforming itself by adding new elements of transforming its programs from one stage to the other, experimentally.
It's interesting to look at this image of the silver hut, which I believe is about 1984, I think, a quarter century ago, roughly, that project, because it seems to be one of the last projects that, in fact, deploys a kind of structural grid of columns and beams. And for the last quarter century, I mean, one way to characterize the work would be to say it's a kind of relentless attack on the idea of a column beam architecture. I'm wondering how conscious the project was when you said at the beginning of the talk that you were interested in a kind of architecture that rejected any kind of symbolism. When you first said that, I imagined that to be in the context of a historical iconography or symbolism from historical forms of either Japanese or modern architecture. The symbol that you seem to most consistently reject is what Colin Rowe or someone, a historian like him, would call the structural grid or frame as a kind of rigid figure. I'm wondering where that came from as a kind of belief and whether it's conscious in the kind of alternative domino models that I think Charles' question was hinting at, which is unlike Le Corbusier with one domino model, which could run through everything, you seem to be creating a catalog of continuous dominoes that are arches, vaults, openings, folded minimal surfaces, all of which take the place of a column grid or a rigid frame.
まあ、そうですね。まとになってるこのアイデア。うん。コルビジェのドミノの影響というより、まあ思想的な影響はあると思います。そのコルビジェのドミノが、まあ、構造体だけを提案して、 そこに、まあ、様々な表層を加えていくことによって建築化していくというような、まあ、そういうことはとても素晴らしいことだというふうに思っていました。で、まあ、ここでなぜ、そのフレーム柱梁ではなくて、この宙に浮かぶような、ボルトが出てきたのかということは、まあ、自分でもよく分からないんですけれども、 まあ、様々なスタディの末に出てきたことで、なかなかそれは説明はできません。It's
very difficult to respond. But the fascination about the domino system referred to Le Corbusier, it's very, very important symbolic project. But at the same time, rejection with the columns and beams and grid system, it's actually very, very important topic and issue either replaced by board or different structural organization. That's kind of ongoing research into
different systems. ただ、今から25年前にこの住宅を考えたときに、なぜシルバーハットという名前をつけたかというと、そのプリミティブハット、都会の中のプリミティブハットとは何だろうかというテーマを立てたわけです。
So for instance, this silver hut built in 25 years ago, actual idea just came from primitive hut, but mislocated in the urban environment, and how to interpret notion of primitive hut in the urban space.
その東京という、その都市の森の中へ出かけていって、そこで集められるものをアセンブルして、この住宅を作るんだ。だから、まあ、それは住んでから、住みながらアセンブルしていってもいいというぐらいの気持ちでした。
So as if you go into the forest of the city and assembling different elements available in this forest, then assembling some unit which you may call hut. So that's the concept of silver hut.
ですからもう一度それと同じことをここでやってみたいと思っているわけです。
So also original intention of relocating those elements, dislocated again from one context to the other, and placed, then try to make new kind of growth patterns according to topography or program, which is a kind of.
まあドア、ドアというのは何だろうか、照明器具というのは何だろうか。キッチンというのは何だろうか、それを全部ゼロに戻して、そこから考え始めるということです。
Also another challenge is to questioning every functional element of the house. What is the door? What is the kitchen? Or what is the floor? Or what is the structures? It's breaking down to every pieces into taxonomy, then we question again in the different context to reinvent the buildings itself.
At some point of your lecture, you mentioned that you were fascinated with ephemerality and also impermanence. I was wondering, I was wondering if you and your buildings, I was wondering if you, when you design a building, you have the notion that.The building has a finite life. It's gonna not gonna last forever. And how? What's that period? If you ever have it.
いや、特にそのフレームはありません。まあ、建築というのは、まあ、私自身はそんなに永久に存続してほしいと自分では思っていないんです。
Generally, I would wish any architecture should remain not too long.
現に、まあ、シルバーハットも東京にあったシルバーハットは解体して、今治にその地方都市に
持っていますシルバーハットを建てて新しいアーキテクチャルを見つけ
てただ80年代に考えていたような仮説性という気持ちは今はなくなりましたそれは仙台以来です
On the other hand, after Sendai projectSome notion of temporality I explored during 80s. These are, may not be the notion of temporality I'm interested in.
それは Sendai project. その Sendai のその中部に対して、まあコンペティションの直後にものすごい反対運動が起こって、この中部をやめてしまえと随分言われた。その時に、まあ自分は絶対にこのチューブだけは絶対に実現するぞ、むしろこのチューブが僕がチューブを守るんじゃなくてチューブが僕を守ってくれるんだという気持ちだった
One of, for example, in during the struggle during the realization of Sendai Mediatheque.There is huge demonstration against those tubular structures from surrounding local groups. Then I have to defend myself, but at the end realizing that actually I will be protected by my tube design. The notion of dependency to the structures and permanency is actually not only structuralism, but at the same time made importance of most.Significant element which makes this project meaningful. So those notions probably might be different notions of temporality.
まあその時からまあ軽くなくてもいいし、そんなに透明でなくてもいいから、強いものを作りたいと思うようにはなりました。
So contrary to the notion of temporality or ephemerality, after Sendai Mediatheque, also equally being fascinated by notion of very strong element, structural element, which also put notion of permanency. So not about the only notion of transparency and lightness, but it's actually combinations of those structural hierarchy as well as spatial expression. Probably you will see the later part of the project.
Hi. From previous projects, I saw an constantly absorption of engineer inputs of different decades. So what I want to ask is, from recent years, like 10 years or 15 years of parametric design trends, what do you think it brings to your design process? And in which point it coherent with your design? And what is your potential expectations of you about this trend? In which point it should benefit architectural design? Thank you.
デザインの可能性っていうのは飛躍的に広がりつつあると思っています。それからストラクチャーのアナリシスに関してもあるいはデザインに関してもこれはまだまだ無限の可能性があって、その一つとしてパラメトリックなデザインというものもその可能性の一つとしてあるだろうと。ただ今のところそれに基づいてアルゴリズムに基づいて、デザインをしてみるとまたそれに非常に拘束されるという不自由さもある、その矛盾の中で今、いろんなことを考えている最中です。
I've seen various projects. They are also close collaboration with the algorithm approach to structural engineer. And most fascinating thing is that those computer analysis on structures or form, it allows us to create something unimaginable in terms of complexity and structural variations, which are really exciting to work with. But at the same time, danger is that sometimes you are controlled by those vocabulary. Then telling myself that actually those variations or parametric is one of the very, very interesting tools. But at the same time, what makes project unique is probably another different type of criteria invited through project by project, which brings certain characteristic of each architecture.
まあ建築っていうのはやっぱり何か生命力を持ったものでなくてはならないっていうことが必ずあって、まあそれを成り立たせるために何を使えばいいかという問題でしかないと思っています。
So I personally think that the architecture should be judged by a capacity of life expression which enabled by provided structures or structural organization and that support those life expressions taking place. That's very, very important.Which may not only came from symbolic form of buildings.
Okay, thank you very much.